so good to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. You ready to worship the Lord this morning? Worship you, Jesus. Give you glory for all you've brought me through. Now I'm ready for whatever you wanna do. Come on, sing it out now. Moving forward to follow after you. Now I'm ready for whatever you wanna do. Come on, sing it out. Your presence is an open door. We want you, Lord, like never before. Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord, like never before. Every season, your grace has been enough.
Come on, do you know that?
I'm believing the best is yet to come. The cross before me, my hope on things above. In you, Jesus, the best is yet to come.
Your presence, come on, sing it out.
Your presence is an open door. We want you, Lord, like ever before. Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord, like never before. I know a breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now.
Come on, sing it out.
I know a breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now. I know, breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now.
Come on, sing it again.
I know, breakthrough is coming. By faith, my God made me a promise and it won't stop now.
We worship you, Jesus. We give you adoration in the house this morning. Come on, can you lift your voice?
We worship you, Jesus. Your presence is an open door. Want you, Lord, like never before.
Come on, sing it out.
Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord,
like never before. Come on, can you love on him? We worship you, Jesus. Adoration belongs to you, Jesus. Give you praise. Hallelujah. Worthy are you, Lord. Come on, sing. I know breakthrough is coming. By faith I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now. I know breakthrough is coming. By faith I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now. I know breakthrough is coming. By faith I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now. I know breakthrough is coming. By faith I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now. Come on and give him praise in the house. Come on, do you believe that? Worthy are you, Lord. We sing glory to your name, Lord. Worthy are you, Lord. Created from dust, you came and you lived among us. You took on our frame, you walked in our pain. Now you're taking us higher. You stepped into time, laid down your life to save us. You took all our shame, on the cross it was laid. Now you're taking us higher. As we go from glory to glory to glory, never be the same, never be the same. We go, as we go from glory to glory to glory, we're forever changed, forever changed. As you call me your friend, brought into your endless kingdom, by the blood I was made, no longer a slave. Now you're taking us higher. As we go from glory to glory to glory, never be the same, never be the same. We go from glory to glory to glory. We're forever changed, forever changed. Until, come on, sing it out now. Until we reach that day, love conquers everything. We'll cry an anthem singing, holy, holy. And when we see that day, we're standing face to face. We'll shout an anthem singing, holy, holy.
took on the grave. So not even death can shake us. The victor has won, and heaven has come. Now you're taking us higher.
Come on, sing it out, church.
Now you're taking us higher.
Here we go.
We go from glory to glory to glory. We'll never be the same. Never be the same.
You take
us. You take us higher. As we go from glory to glory to glory, we'll never be the same, never be the same. You take us, you take us higher and higher and higher. We're forever changed, forever changed. We go from glory to glory to glory.
We go.
We go from glory to glory to glory. You take us higher and higher and higher. We're forever changed, forever changed.
Come on and give Him praise. Come on and give Him praise. Come on, give Him adoration this morning. Lord, you are taking us, Lord, from glory to glory. Come on, give Him praise. Come on, give Him praise. Come on, speak it into existence. Hallelujah, Lord. Worthy are you, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. As we move into worship this morning, Lord, will you just captivate our hearts? Lord, will you just lay our burdens down from the week, God? God, anything, Lord, that we carried in, Lord, I pray, Lord, right now, Lord, that in your presence, God, Scripture tells us that where the liberty of the Lord is, or where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Amen. Do you believe that this morning? So we say, Holy Spirit, come dwell in this place. Holy Spirit, come dwell in this place, not this building, but Lord, in this heart of mine. Lord, just move amongst your people this morning. We worship you, Jesus. Come on, stretch your hands towards heaven. Come on, stretch your hands towards heaven. Come on, just begin to love on Him.
Revealed in you are Christ.
What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. Come on now. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. Come on, see it out. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. We worship you, Jesus. Worthy are you, Lord. Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring. The praise of your glory. For you are raised. This heart, you have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever. God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ our King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. Come on, sing it out. The name of, come on, sing it out. Come on, lift your voice. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. We say your name, Jesus. We speak your name, Jesus, over our nation, Lord. We speak your name, Jesus. Sweet name of Jesus. Worthy are you, Lord. Worthy are you, Lord. Worthy are you, Lord. Jesus. At this moment, I want you to think about where Jesus has brought you from and where he has kept you from. I want you to think about the goodness of the Lord over your life and where you would be if he hadn't kept you. I don't know about you, but when I think about that, I begin to think about the goodness of God and how he's kept me. Come on, let's sing it out. Come on, Zaylee, sing it out. You're never gonna let me down. to just love on him this morning. Lord, you're good. You're good, Lord. Worthy are you, Lord. You're good, Lord. You're good. Oh, you've been so good to me. Come on, sing it one more time, Zaylee. Come on, lift your voice.
You are good. You're good.
Worship you, Jesus. Praise in this place. If he's been good to you, come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Give him praise. Worthy are you, Lord. 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 I don't know about you, but something's stirring in my heart today. And I believe that it's the presence of the Lord. And I'm here to tell you that God is about to move and God is going to do something great if you'll just open up your heart this morning. Come on. If you can have a seat today, do this. Look across the church at somebody that you didn't and wave at them and smile at them. If you want, you know, just let acknowledge them. And tell them it's good to see them. You can just lip it. You can say, it's good to see you, you know, if you need to do that. So it's so good to see you. And what an honor to see everybody and to have you here at our second service of the day. And our first service was an amazing time before the Lord. But I believe that God's got something in store for you in this service. Amen. Do you believe that? I believe that. I am charged in my spirit. This week has just been a crazy week, and there's a lot going on in the world. But can I tell you something? With everything that's going on in the world, God is still on the throne. God is still on the throne. He's still sovereign, and God is still moving in the land. And whether we want to see it or not realize it, God is still there. And I believe that God has given me a word, and I don't want to keep you too long this morning. I don't want to be eternal with my words that I'm going to speak to you today. But I do have something that I feel like the Holy Spirit has dropped in my heart, and I believe it is a timely word for the church, not talking just specifically this church, but for the church, for the people of God to hear at this time. I saw this story, and I want to start by just starting with this story. One day, a farmer's donkey fell into an abandoned well. The animal cried for hours as the farmer tried to figure out a way to get the donkey out. Finally, he decided that the animal was old and well needed to just be covered up anyway, so it just wasn't worth for him to try to retrieve the donkey. So I invited all his neighbors to come over and to help him, and they each grabbed a shovel and began to shovel dirt into the well. Realizing what was happening, the donkey would scream and wailed horribly. Then a few shovelfuls later, he quieted down completely. The farmer peered down into the well and was astounded by what he saw. With every shovel of dirt that hit the back of the donkey, he was doing something amazing. He would just shake it off. And as he shook it off, a new layer of dirt would appear on the ground. And as the farmer's neighbors continued to shovel dirt on top of the animal, he would shake it off and he would take a step up. Pretty soon, the donkey stepped up and over the ledge of the well and trotted off. To the shock and the astonishment of all the neighbors, life is going to shovel some dirt on you. How many of you know that? At times, life is going to throw you some curveballs and it's going to shovel some dirt on you. The trick is, getting out of the well is to not let yourself be buried by the dirt that's being thrown on you, but to shake it off and to step on it and watch God propel you. Amen. I think that's a great story. I want to talk to you today on this simple subject. You can look at the nearest person to you and say, shake it off. Everyone say, shake it off. Shake it off.
And I am going to, if you have your Bibles, and I want to apologize in advance, our projector decided to do something this morning, and we don't know what happened to it, but it just decided to just quit on us, but it's not there, so sorry, the words are not going to be there, but they'll be over here on the side. If you have your Bibles, go to 2 Corinthians. We're going to be in the first chapter, verses 3 through 5. And I've got a couple of translations here, different translations, and there's a reason that I wanted to do that, just to clarify, just so you know where we're going. If, when you have it, say amen. It says this, 2 Corinthians 1, chapter 3, it says, all praise to God. It doesn't say some praise. It doesn't say when I feel like praise, and it says all praise. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is our merciful Father and the source of all comfort. Everyone say comfort. Verse 2, he comforts us in all of our troubles so that we can comfort others. When they are troubled, we will be able to give them the same comfort God has given us. For the more we suffer for Christ, the more God will shower us with his comfort through Christ. The Message, I would call it a paraphrase. I wouldn't really call it a word-for-word translation. Sometimes I like to look at the Message just to see how it says it. And it says it like this. All praise to God and Father of our Master Jesus, the Messiah. Father of all mercy, God of all healing counsel. Amen. He comes alongside us when we go through hard times. Aren't you glad for that? And before you know it, he brings us alongside someone else who is going through hard times so that we can be there for that person just as God was there for us. Do you see a correlation here of what's happening? We have plenty of hard times that come from the from following the Messiah, but no more so than the good times of his healing and comfort there. I like what it says there. Yeah, we have some hard times, but I want to remind you that there have been some good times there. And then the last part of that says we get a full measure of that too. We don't just get trials and circumstances. We also get good times with the Lord. Amen. A.W. Tozer was a great minister of a previous generation, and he said this, and when I was looking at this verse, matter of fact, if you look at the translation of this verse in let's say the New King James Version, and maybe even the NLT, verses 3 through 7, the word comfort appears in that part of Scripture 10 times. The word comforts is in there. And A.W. Tozer, he made a statement one time, and he said it like this. He said, it is doubtful whether God can bless a man greatly until he hurts him deeply. Let me repeat that in case you didn't hear that. It is doubtful whether God can bless a man greatly until he has hurt him deeply. Now, that goes against a lot of what I would call prosperity teaching that you hear a lot of nowadays. You mean God's going to let me go through some things? Yes. God never said that this world, that it would be just all merry-go-rounds and exciting and all only good times. But what Tozer, let me translate that. What he is saying there is, you're going to go through some stuff, but here's why. God's going to use you when you go through some stuff. You may have to go through some failures. Anybody been through some failures? Made some bad mistakes? How about some setbacks? Anybody been through a few setbacks? Maybe sickness. What about defeat? Maybe you've dealt with death. Can I tell you this? When we go through those things, they're not for our glory. They are for his glory. Capital H there. His glory. Not ours. See, there's two things here that I want to point out in this text. That just basically says this. God's going to allow you to go through some things because God's going to use you to help someone else who's going through something similar. You guys with me? All right, good, good. See, there are two non-negotiable prerequisites for being used by God. Two non-negotiable things. And I want to point this out. In the Scripture, it tells us that Jesus said the law hangs on two things, right? He says it hangs on the love the Lord God with all your heart, right? Mind and soul. And what's the other one? Love your as yourself. So two things the cross. I have this vertical relation, love the Lord God with all my heart, and I have this horizontal relationship with others, love my neighbor as myself, and we're going to get into that. But two things, they're non-negotiable. If God's going to use you, you need to understand this is what you need to be. Number one, okay? Number one, you can write this down. This is just, I'm laying a foundation here. I promise you I will not keep you long, but I'm laying a foundation. Number one is this, compassion for people. Everyone say compassion for people. Compassion means this, sympathetic pity and concerns for the misfortunes and sufferings of others. Compassion. Compassion fuels acts of kindness and mercy, right? I love seeing a good story where someone is compassionate and they're helping someone out, right? It's a beautiful thing, right? And the older I get, when I see something like that on Facebook, I just start to cry. I guess just because I'm getting old. I don't know. I'm just more sensitive than I used to be in my younger years. But I see compassion, and compassion is this. It's a form of love. It is aroused within us when we are confronted with those who are suffering or are vulnerable. Compassion often produces action to alleviate the suffering. Compassion causes us to move, to take a step, to do something. See, Jesus responded with compassion. It wasn't enough for him to say, oh, I feel sorry for you. But when Jesus was moved with compassion, he always did something about it. It's not enough for us as a church to say, oh, man, I feel bad about all that's going on in the world. But we are compelled to do something about it. See, Jesus did that. You remember when Jesus, he had compassion on the blind man. Guess what? The blind man could see. When Jesus had compassion on the crowd, he fed them. He met a need. And as the church, let me ask you this, are we meeting the needs of the people around us? Are we following Jesus' example? Jesus talked about compassion a lot. He told the story of the prodigal son and how the father had compassion on the son. He said, my son may be a knucklehead, he may have done something, he may have betrayed me, but let me tell you something, I love him. It says he sat there and he was waiting on him, and when he saw him, he ran to him. He had compassion on him. And see, Jesus responded with compassion. He didn't just act in compassion. He actually moved in action on compassion. Can I tell you this? God has called his church, that's you and me, to rise up in this time of uncertainty and to move in compassion for others. Now that's easy to talk about, but that's harder to do. Do you know that this world, there's a lot of uncertainty, but this world is lost, it's hurting, and there are dying people in the world, and they need the compassion of the body of Christ, the people, to just reach out to them and just love on them with a love like Jesus would. Not just talking about it, doing something about it. Man, I don't know, when I thought about this week, man, it really put me in my place. See, Mark 12:31 tells us this. It tells us to what? Love our neighbor as ourself. I don't know about you, but I love myself. Do any of you struggle with that? I don't think any of us struggle with loving ourselves. Matter of fact, if there are, at our house, if there's three chicken breasts, I'm going to grab the chicken breast that I think looks best for me and not worry about anybody else, right? Come on now. But we love ourselves, but where we struggle is loving our neighbor. I told the first service in a moment that I had when I was making a trip to the airport one time, and I stopped to get some gas on the way back from the airport. I dropped someone off. And when I was there, this young mom showed up, and she had a baby and a toddler. And she came up to me, and she said, I'm struggling, and I'm on my way. I just got out of a domestic violence relationship, and I'm just trying to get out of town. I need some gas money. She didn't even ask me for gas money. She said, I just need to get some food for my baby. Can you help me get some food for my baby? And I remember thinking, yeah, I can do that. I can do that for you. And I remember I walked into the store and I started buying the cheapest things I could find in that convenience store. And as I filled up my hands for all this stuff for her baby, I was walking to the checkout and the Holy Spirit said, would you buy that stuff for your baby? Point taken. You know what I did? I put all that stuff back. I walked outside. I said, hey, I want you to come in here. And I said, I want you to pick what you want to give to your baby. that was a moment for me where I learned, you know what? I need to love that person like I love myself. Because guess what? If Wyatt wanted something, if Wyatt wanted a particular type of drink, I would have given Wyatt that drink. But just because that wasn't my child doesn't mean that I shouldn't love that person like I love myself. See, it's easy to love ourselves, but it's harder to love others like we love ourselves. So that's the first thing, is compassion for people. Number two, right here, confidence in God. Everyone say confidence in God. Verse 4 in our text says this: He comforts us in all troubles. It says He comforts us in some troubles, a couple of our troubles. No, it says He comforts us in all troubles. If you're going through something right now, I don't know about you, I look at that and my confidence begins to grow. No matter what I'm going through, it says He will comfort me in that moment. Shut up, devil. Confidence in God is a learned trait as a believer. It is a learned trait as a believer. It's learned through experience, and it's learned through the Word of God. If you don't know what God is saying about you, you're going to have a misinterpretation of how He loves you and how He wants the best for you. See, when we take inventory of where God has brought us from, have you ever stopped and just thought, I cannot believe that I am where I am? Because had it not been for God, had it not been for the grace of God, where would I be at this moment? I don't know about you. When I go back and I look at what God has brought me through and how He kept me and how I should have been dead and how I shouldn't be alive, He has kept me. I can't help but gain confidence that He is going to keep me. God said He would keep His word. He's not a man that would lie. It's what the scripture says, that God will not lie. So if God says it about you, you can stand on it and take it to the bank. Talk about good credit. God has great credit. David in Psalms, you know, I love David because David was one of those guys, he just encouraged himself always. And if you read any of the Psalms or many of the Psalms that he wrote, he would write things and he would always start just low and like, man, the world is falling apart, God, and they're attacking me on this side. And by the end of the whatever he's writing, he's always flipping around saying, God, You are victorious, and I thank You for keeping me. In Psalm 27, it says this, verses 11, it says this. It says, teach me how to live, O Lord. Lead me along the right path, for my enemies are waiting for me. You ever felt like your enemies were waiting for you? So David's saying that, and he says this. Do not let me fall into their hands, for they accuse me of things I've never done. With every breath, they threaten me with violence. Sounds familiar. Sounds like today, doesn't it, right? What we're living through. Yet I am confident. Everyone say confident. I will see the Lord's goodness while I am here in the land of the living. That's confidence that God is going to pull me out. My enemies may be surrounding me, but God, I am trusting You. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. That is confidence in the Lord. Stormy times, they come. They happen. But God has called us to remain confident in Him. Let me tell you something. If you put your confidence in the government, you're going to be let down. If you put your confidence in a political ideology, you're going to be let down. If you put your confidence in the elections, you're going to be let down. If you put your confidence in man-made philosophies, you're going to be let down. But let me tell you something. I want to encourage you. Put your confidence in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. It's simple, really. Compassion for others, confidence in God, right? It's really simple. I love that. The simple gospel right there. Love the Lord God with all your heart. Love your neighbor as yourself. That's really the two things that we have to live on. And God, I believe that God has given me a word for this season. Honestly, I mean, it's just been pouring it over my heart. And I want to speak that to you today. And I pray that the Holy Spirit speaks to your heart as I share these next three truths that I believe that God has for us. In Acts chapter 27, and we're not going to read it, but in Acts chapter 27, Paul is with 270 men, and they're in a boat, and they're going through the Mediterranean Sea traveling, And in this boat, it's just bobbing up and down in the middle of a storm. And on this boat, there are prisoners, there are sailors, and there are Roman guards, okay? On this boat, about 270 men, and they're caught up in the storm. Some are good, some are bad, some are indifferent. And it's just like us today. You know what? There are in America right now, we're going through a storm. Some are good, some are bad, some are indifferent, right? It doesn't matter. So this is what I know. This is the first truth, and you can write this down, is number one, as a believer, as a church, if you come to Christ, let me tell you something. You are going to have to face a storm. Number one, face the storm. John 16:33 says this, and I like what Jesus says here. He says, I have told you all this so that you may have peace in me. Here on earth, you will have what? Many trials and sorrows. I like Jesus. He gets straight to the point. You're going to have some bad things happen. But listen to this. But take heart because I have overcome the world. Notice it doesn't say, here on earth, you will have many trials and sorrows, so you should feel like the world has overtaken you. No. He says, take heart. He said, remember this thing, no matter what you're going through, no matter what you're facing, I have overcome the world. In Matthew 5:45, Jesus said it like this. He said, it rains on the just and the unjust. If you're a believer, you're going to have some bad situations. If you're an unbeliever, you're going to have some bad situations. Guess what? As a believer, I'm going to face some deaths in my life. As an unbeliever, I'm going to face some deaths in my life. God never once said that we wouldn't go through it, but he did, however, say he would walk through it with us. And that's the difference between a believer and a non-believer. So back in Acts, so we're looking at that, and there's Paul, and there's all these prisoners, and there's sailors, and there's Roman guards, and they're all in this together, right, from different walks of life. And just like that, in society, we live in a country, we're all from different walks of life. We're all in this together, right? Sometimes we're going to face a storm together. We're all on the same ship. We're all in the American ship, right? But what I like is Paul didn't run. Now, I know he was a prisoner, so he probably couldn't run. But I know that he had favor with the Roman centurion because he got out, and the Roman centurion let him go talk to some of his friends in one of the places that they stopped. But Paul didn't run. He wasn't worried. He wasn't scared of the storm. And just like the world today, we are going to have to ride this ship and speak the truth to a lost and dying world. Not your truth. And one of the things that I can't stand about this young generation, they say, well, this is my truth. I don't know what your truth is. My truth needs to line up with this truth. This is the truth. Your feelings don't matter when God said it. Amen. I know that's tough. I know that's rough. But let me tell you something. It is what we need in our society. See, we're going to have to ride a ship and we're going to have to speak truth to a lost and dying world. Understand that we may be heading for a hard wreck. Oh, man, DJ, this is doom and gloom. This is really, that's the reality of anything. We don't know what tomorrow holds. We don't know what the Lord's doing. I know he's sovereign. I know no matter what happens, I'm going to trust him. See, as a believer, we have to be confident in God. And it goes back to that. Be confident in God. Be compassionate to others. We're all going to be in the same storm, right? We're there right now. Is there anybody in here who has not been affected by the coronavirus? We're all in it together, right? So let me tell you something. We need to learn to be confident in God and compassionate towards others. Here's number two. I like this. This one's not very fun, but I like this one. Is this. Get to work. Get to work. That's not popular. That's not a popular one. Get to work. What I like about this story is, so there's Paul. And after being out in a storm for 14 days, bobbing up and down, I don't know about you, I wouldn't want to be on stormy seas for 14 days. I'm sure it was uncomfortable. I don't even want to be on a storm for like a few hours. That wouldn't be very fun. So for 14 days, they struggled with the storm. They were just, you know, having so many issues. And then eventually they started throwing stuff overboard to lighten the ship. And they eventually just, the ship started to break apart. And everybody, and Paul told them before it broke apart, he said, hey, if we're going to wreck, the ship's going to wreck, just so you know, everything's going to break. You guys need to eat something. And I thank God for God's sustaining grace. He always tells us, hey, you need to prep for right now. You need to get ready because something is coming. You need to be ready for this. So he said, let's eat something. And so when they're doing that and they're going through the trouble there, and the ship begins to break apart, and they're grabbing what they can hang on to, and they're swimming to shore. And Paul says this. He says, you know, basically this. He says, we're all going to make it. No one's going to perish. I like that confidence. I like that confidence. And he told him that. But this is what I know. Charles Swindoll says this. He said, life is 10% of what happens to you and 90% of how you respond. I like that. I think that is so true in our lives. But let me tell you what I believe happens. I think we act the other way. I feel like that we make it about 90% of what's happening to us and 10% of our response. This has happened to me. Right? We're all guilty of that. But look at this. Paul does something amazing, and I think it's a great example for us as a church and a great example as believers. Paul gets, once he hits the ground, you know what? That says that the native people there, they built big fires for them because they had just been in a storm and they were cold and it was raining. And so they built these huge fires, and Paul does something that's amazing. I don't know if he was told to do it. I don't know but whatever the case, he goes out and he starts gathering sticks to put in the fire. And he responds by gathering firewood. And he starts helping to stoke the fire. See, here's what I learned. And listen to me. I'm going to say this out of love. We are accustomed to coming to church and letting someone else stoke the fire, and we just sit there and warm up by the fire instead of stoking the fire. In prayer, when's the last time you stoked the fire in prayer? When's the last time that you laid before the Lord and just wailed? I heard a lady this week, but she was travailing in the spirit, and I hadn't heard that in such a long time, and my heart just began to break, and I thought, man, Lord, we need more people to travail like that, that will throw fire on, that will throw wood on the fire, that the Holy Spirit can just begin to burn, and that people's lives would be changed. See, Paul, when he hit the ground, he didn't go warm up by the fire. He went to work because someone else's need was more important than his own. And the way that God works is when you bless someone else, he blesses you, right? See, I think we oftentimes, we come into church and we say, oh, Pastor Mark, stoke the fire in my life because I can't make it this week unless you stoke the fire. And it's not your pastor's responsibility alone. I think our pastors are encouraging, and I think that they need to be, and I think that that's great. But let me tell you something. There's a personal responsibility of you as a believer. You should be stoking the fire of this church in prayer. But week after week, we come in, I'll enjoy the fire of this Sunday, but don't expect me to contribute to it. And I say this, God forgive us. God forgive me. Right? See, we've become so comfortable by the fire. And it's easy to do. We get there. Oh, this is enjoyable. I don't have to do anything at this moment. And TJ, you don't understand what I've been going through. I can't stoke the fire. I have anxiety. Probably because you're not praying. I'm struggling with my job. Well, have you prayed about it? Here's the thing. And I say this in love. God has not called you to occupy a pew, but to stoke the fire. This week, I made a phone call earlier this week. And I woke up in the morning, and the Holy Spirit just told me, said, you need to contact this gentleman. And I thought, Lord, I have not talked to this person in a while, but the Holy Spirit just checked me and said, you need to contact this person and encourage them. Like, okay, God. And I thought, This is, can either go one of two ways. This is either going to go good or this is going to go bad. I'm going to either gain a friend or keep a friend or lose a friend right here. I didn't know how they were going to respond. I learned from this person. So I sent my little fleece text out and said, hey, is this so-and-so, you know? Like, is this you? And yeah, this is. And I just felt compelled by the Holy Spirit. And I said, God, give me the words to speak to this person. And the Holy Spirit just said, just tell him that you love him and encourage him. I was like, okay, I think I can do that. And so I did that. And before our conversation ended, he sent me a message and he said, listen, you encouraged me. I was down. I was angry. I was upset about situations. And he said, let me tell you something. He goes, you changed my whole perspective. Thank you. Something simple. Stoke the fire. Stoke the fire. See, and Paul does something that's very selfless here. Rather than warming himself by the fire, he's feeding the fire. Can I ask you this? How are you stoking the fire of others in your life? Compassion for others, loving your neighbor. And there he is, walking up and down the beach, grabbing sticks, planks, whatever, to just take to the fire. But I don't know about you, but I can't help but get convicted of how selfish I am at times. God, I expect you to feed the fire. Lord, I expect when I come in that things to be a certain way, but I haven't spent any time in personal prayer. I haven't spent any time in personal study. I haven't spent any time. God, forgive us, right? Here's the last thing. Second one's get to work. Last one is this. Shake it off. Everyone say, shake it off. And so you guys know the story. Paul's gathering sticks, and in the process of gathering sticks, he's putting them on the fire. And it says that there's a poisonous viper there, or a snake, poisonous snake that's in the fire, that either in the sticks that he's carrying, but it's cold maybe. And so when he puts it on the fire, the snake quickly comes to life. I know I would come to life if I sat down in a fire. And the snake responds by biting Paul on the hand. Well, that's the last time I'm going to help the Lord. Right? And so the viper bites him on the hand, and scripture tells us that Paul does something amazing, and I love what he does there, is he just shakes it off and goes away in the fire. Can I tell you something? When the Holy Spirit starts moving, when the fire gets hot, when the Holy Spirit is moving, listen, the viper is going to try to distract you. He's going to try to confuse you. He's going to try to hit you where you are vulnerable. Paul was vulnerable at that moment in his hand. And the enemy attacked. Can I tell you something about snakes? Snakes are not offensive animals. They're defensive animals. They don't want to mess with you. If they see you from a distance, they try to stay away from you if at all possible. But if you back them in a corner, you better get ready because I'm going to strike you. And that's the way the enemy works. And that's what the enemy does. When the fire's hot and he's being backed into the corner, the only thing the enemy knows to do is to strike you where you are weak. And let me tell you something, it never fails. When you're surrendering to God, when you're doing something for God, it feels like the enemy strikes the hardest at those moments. God, I'm just trying to do something for you, and that person was mean to me. And I can't tell you, when I called my friend, I felt very much intimidated. I thought the enemy was lying to me, saying, what if he says this? What if they do this? What if they respond this way? And I kept playing that over, and I thought to my mind, you know what? I have to shake off what this doubt that the enemy's put in me because the Holy Spirit has told me to do something. Amen? See, the enemy's desire is this. It's to steal, kill, and destroy you. But Jesus came that you may have life, and life what? More abundantly. You know, in this time, the church has to be more discerning than we've ever been. The problem is we got to stop seeing things through the lens of social media. Through the news media. Now, it's easy to get caught up in. Now, listen, it's part of all. I think social media can be a wonderful thing. But let me tell you something. In a time like this, one of the best things you can do is step back from that. Because there's a lot of opinions floating around here and there. But what you need to find is the opinion that matters the most, the truth of Jesus Christ. Listen, I know that's a good word right there. I needed to hear that word. If you didn't need to hear that word. oftentimes in the process of serving others, the enemy will attack us, right? He'll hit us in the hardest and in the greatest way and in one of our weakest points. Why? Because you're doing something for the kingdom. Paul's helping someone else, warmed by the fire. And you guys remember the story, right? It's amazing to me. I like what Paul does. If it would have been me, Paul shakes it off into the fire. But if it had been me, I'd have grabbed a stick and a rock and I'd have beat that thing. He said, before I die, I'm going to kill you too. Right? But Paul doesn't. How he responds is he's bitten by a snake and he shakes it off. Listen to this. I love this. And 2 Corinthians chapter 10 says this. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. Let me repeat that for you. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. Listen to us. Listen to me. We try to fight spiritual battles in our own physical way. And God never intended us to fight from a physical standpoint. You can't fight a spiritual battle in your physical realm. So it says this. And Paul understood that when he's writing this. Verse 4 says this. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. Amen. Casting down arguments, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. I don't care what social media is saying. This is the word that I'm going to listen to. I don't care what your favorite preacher's saying and their opinion may be. If it doesn't line up with this, you better check who your favorite preacher is. See, my job, I like what Paul does. My job is not to try to fight those things. Paul, he knew he's in the physical realm, but he knew there was a spiritual thing happening there, and he just shook it off. And Paul's bitten by that poisonous snake, and there he is, and he shakes it off in the fire. But Paul had something. He had confidence in God. Now, remember the natives, they're sitting there watching them. And let me tell you something. They had experienced the snakes and the vipers, and they lived on that island. So they knew when they saw that snake, they thought, okay, you survived that storm. You're a murderer because you're about to die because you just got bit by a snake. And they sit there, and they just waited for him and waited for him to die. And then when he didn't perish and it didn't swell up and things didn't get bad, remember, they thought he was some god. They said, you're a deity. And Paul, you know, as the story goes on, you know, he goes into the man's house and he heals the man. And all the natives, they find out that basically they come to know who Christ is because of Paul's reaction. Listen, as the church, we've got to stop reacting quickly. We've got to shake fear off. We got to shake anger off. We got to shake things off and stop being reactionary and say, hey, God's got this. I'm confident. I'm going to love people and I'm confident that God is going to bring us out. Where does our confidence come from? It comes from God. See, I like this, and I'm going to end with this, and I promise I'm not going to keep you very much longer here. Paul's confidence came from this one thing, and I like this. If you go back to Acts chapter 27, you'll see where Paul's confidence comes from. In verse 23 and 25, the angel of the Lord appeared to Paul in the ship before it wrecked. And he told Paul this. He said, don't fear. He said, yeah, the ship's going to wreck and, you know, all this. But I'm going to tell you where you're going. See, the angel of the Lord told him, said, hey, you're going to see Caesar and you're going to be on trial and you're going to see him. So where you're at right now, it may seem stormy, and it may seem scary, and it may seem like you that, but you need to remind yourself of what God said about you, about where you're going. So when the storm came, the ship broke apart, and he warned them, and he gave them good counsel to eat and get strong before they got in the water, and he did those things. And when he landed on the beach, and he began to grab things, and the snake and the viper bit him, he understood something. This is not where it ends for him. And I don't know about you, but I grow in confidence when I hear that. Confidence in the Lord. Can I tell you this? The storm won't take you. A poisonous snake won't take you. But one thing I can tell you this, when you are doing good, when you are doing something in ministry and you're blessing people and you're working towards ministry and the viper does strike, let me tell you what God is doing. When he allows something to happen to you, when you have a death in the family, when something bad happens to you, well, let me tell you what God is doing. God is seasoning you for when a moment's going to come along. Someone is going to come alongside you. You can say, listen, I had a death in my family too. And let me tell you something. God can help you. God can bring you through this. Let me tell you how God helped me get through that. Let me share the goodness of God. Will you stand with me all across this building? Can I tell you this? I got news for you. Whether you realize it or don't realize it, society is watching how the church is responding in this moment. Are we acting scared? Are we acting afraid? Are we moving in fear? Because let me tell you something. There's a lot of fear in the world today. Fear is gripping hearts like it never has before. Number two, they're watching how we are responding to the anger and frustration in our society right now. And how we respond, just like the native people, they're watching Paul, and how we respond to the viper attack, they're sitting there going, well, is the church going to live? Is it going to die? But I don't know about you, but I have enough confidence in my God to know what he said about us. See, God is coming back for a church, and I believe this right now, that God is separating the weed and the chaff, and God is preparing hearts. He's cleaning hearts up because God is coming for a pure bride. And I fear as people of God, we've let some things sink in that don't belong there. God's saying, I need to clean that up. I need to get that out of you. We've been complacent and we've sat by the fire long enough and we've depended on other people to pump us up. When God's saying, no, 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 I've called you to stoke the fire. I've called you to pray like you've never prayed before. We love to quote 2 Chronicles 7:14, you know, and you know, if we pray that God will heal our land. Well, guess what? You need to pray. You have to pray like you've never prayed before. You want results like you've never had before? You're going to have to do something like you've never done before. You want revival? You're going to have to reach towards God. Scripture tells us to draw nigh to God, and he'll draw nigh to you. He's not a man, the scripture says, he's not a man that would lie. His promises are yes and amen. I don't know about you, but I have so much confidence in God, and I needed this week. I don't know about you guys, but I needed this week. And I also needed to be reminded, you know what? I need to love my neighbor like I love myself. That means you got to love the person that cut you off, the person that's not standing 6 feet from you at the grocery store. You need to love the person that doesn't wear a mask where they're supposed to be wearing a mask. And you need to love the person that cusses you out or didn't get your order right. Let's do this. Lord, Heavenly Father, God, forgive us. God, forgive us for missing it. God, the gospel is simple. It's loving you and loving others. God, we've overcomplicated things. God, we haven't tried to. We didn't intend to. But the simplistic gospel, God, goes forth, God, when we move in the power and the anointing that you've called us to do. God, what a fitting word for a time where storms, where it feels like we're in a storm and things are just brewing and the waves are choppy and it looks scary and we don't, from day to day, it changes. But God, our response is this, God, we're going to be confident in you. God, we're going to get to work for you. We know we're going to have to face the storm, but God, we are going to get to work for you. God, we're going to do something that we've never done before. to step out of our comfort zone. God, we're going to begin to stoke the fire and not just sit by the fire. And God, when the enemy comes in and attacks, God, we're not going to respond out of reaction. God, we're going to respond out of what you have said and what we believe and what we know is you. God, our confidence is in you. God, we shake off anything from the enemy. God, we shake off distraction. We shake off anger. We shake off fear. In the name of Jesus, God, Lord, let your church prevail. Holy Spirit, I pray right now, Lord, that you would begin to just heal hearts right now. God, forgive us. God, we repent. God, we repent. We just say, God, we're sorry that we've made it so many different things and not about you and loving others, God. God, what a great reminder today. I'm going to pray for you. I'm just going to say a word of prayer. Lord, I thank you, God, for each and every person, Lord. And if they have a need today, Lord, God, I ask, Lord, that you would reach and that you would meet that need. You are God who loves us unconditionally, God. We may mess up, we may make mistakes, but God, your love is still there, just like the prodigal, the father, Lord, is sitting there just saying, come home. I've been waiting for you. Come home. God, you are a God of compassion and mercy, Lord, that we don't deserve. Come on, if you're here today and under the sound of my voice, you don't know Jesus, just say this prayer with me. Say, Jesus, please forgive me for all my sins. God, I'm sorry. I ask, Lord, that you would come into my heart. Lord, that you would take up vacancies in my heart. God, things that I've replaced you with, that they would be.
About that all week, shaking it off. It's what we need to do. And be praying for your pastor. He'll be back Tuesday. And I want to let you know another announcement. We do have our offering box in the back. You can leave your offering, your tithe there. That's how we're having, and we will continue to do that. So that is a new normal that we're going to be doing. But I want to let you know that normally we would have Promotion Sunday, and it's usually the first Sunday in June. And we've had 12 of our kids that are going to be promoted. And I'm looking at some of them back there with Sue. I think you've got three of them, maybe four of them. And we have 12 altogether. We have some going out of children's ministry. We have six junior hires promoting out of junior high going into high school. We have three high schoolers, and we have two that have graduated. Is it CSUB, I think? And I know one of those just graduated for the teaching program. And are they both teacher? I think they are. I think they're both through the teaching program. So we're even going to honor the college graduates and that, which we should. It's going to be a little different. We aren't going to have them all up here. It's going to be at 10:30 between the services next week. So our 9 a.m. service is over by around 10:30. And then our 11 o'clock service, if you will come just a little bit early, and that way we can do that at 10:30 between the services, and hopefully it'll all work. Again, you know what? When he said that earlier about somebody, have you ever, you know, been upset when someone walked in without a mask on? I don't know about you, but have you walked into a place of business and you go, I forgot my mask? And I've done that, you know, so hopefully I didn't make anybody too mad. And I told him in the early service, I looked down in the door of my car because I realized I didn't have a mask. And there was some paper napkins from Chipotle where I'd gone to. So I just grabbed the napkins and put them over my face, you know. But we're figuring it out. We're really trying to do everything we can. And I'm sure we're all going to make somebody mad because we didn't do it just right. And but you know what? We are trying to become all things to all people. When in Rome, do as the Romans do. I mean, all those things we're hearing just flooding our minds. But we feel like these kids, our elementary, junior high, high school, and our college, we want to celebrate them every year. And we've been doing this would have been our 30th promotion Sunday. And so we will do that next Sunday at 10:30. We're still having the 9 a.m. service. We're still having the 11 a.m. service. And it is Father's Day. So we're going to be honoring all dads next Sunday. And our theme is foundations. And so we'll be doing that next Sunday also. So combining a lot in next Sunday. And you're looking around and you might think, you know, there's not a lot in this service, maybe in the other, but we're still staying by the guidelines that we can't go over 25% of capacity in our building. So the early service, we're at that. And surprisingly, you can, with what I counted in here, we could have only maybe had another 15 in here. So if we combine both, we would be way over. So we're still having to stay separate. You all are being very adult and mature about it. Thank you so much for this. And we just say blessings over you. Pray, if you guys would pray that they would up the percentage inside a building. And if they would up that from 25% to even 50%, just pray that. I've been praying, God, I think we can handle that. We're going to be mature in our gatherings, right? And I think that'd be very important. It'd be great if they would say go back to 100% occupancy. But that could happen. Who knows? A miracle could happen, right? But let's target. Let's bump it up where we can do that. And with us not being a hot spot here in our area, let's just pray that happens. And I would love to see us all together in one service again. That would be, it's kind of my heart's desire is, and God give us our heart's desire, right? And love you all very much. You are dismissed. And have a blessed, blessed week.